Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for the opportunity. As you've just heard, I'm from Africa, and our problems are quite different from the problems that you face. I don't know when last you've travelled in Africa, but we still have problems with elephant crossing the roads. We still have problems with giraffe and wild animals. And if that's not enough, we've got donkeys and we've got children running over roads. We do not have infrastructure. Africa has been left with a vast growing population. Our urbanization problem is absolutely immense. We don't know what to do. We've got four-hour gridlock in our cities at the moment. And I'm not talking about South Africa. South Africa is bad. The rest of Africa is 10 times worse. Everyone's trying to develop the economy. Everyone wants to be middle class. And the first thing you do when you join the middle class is you want your own car. But there's no more roads. There's no infrastructure and there's no money to build roads. We don't have buses. We don't have trains. We don't have trams. We don't have undergrounds. So trust me, the problem is growing every single year and it is bad. So the solution I'm going to show you now was developed over the past 30 years in isolation. It was different types of problems that led us to the solution, and I've been struggling with the problem for a long time. And I came to the conclusion that the only way we can actually solve the problems is to have a complete new look at the way we move around. We can't use more right-of-way. We can't create more right-of-way. We have to use new ways of moving around. Use the existing right-of-way you've got. And the only way we can do that is go up into the air. We can't stop the migration of animals. So go up in there and still use the land below. Let the animals still walk. And that's where the system came from. Okay, so first of all, I am a corporate strategist. I'm not an engineer. So the whole business philosophy we're going to share with you now is based on a business, is based on making a change, is based on going to market, not creating another technology. So the technology that was created after we started implementing it, we realized that when we want to implement this for people, it's going to take us 12, 15 years to negotiate with politicians about the safety and the new technology and the problems and the environmentals and everything else. However, if you apply this to something else that doesn't die when it falls, like a piece of rock or coal or iron ore, it's a lot easier. There's mines that need cost-effective solutions right now that can pay for their own the land, and they've got a huge, huge, huge requirement. So we started applying the same technology first in the mining industry, and from there we will migrate to people. The philosophy being, hey, but it's been running there for millions of kilometers, why can't we put people on there as well? And that was the philosophy. And when we started applying that, a very, very funny thing started happening. For the first time in my life, as a salesman and a strategist, I'm standing in front of clients who tell me, Andries, do you know what this thing is going to do for us? And I'm standing there thinking, I think so. And they start explaining to us that we are going to change the industry. And they start bringing their engineers to the party, and they start showing us what this thing is going to do for them. And when we started looking at that, we suddenly realized we can transform mining, we can transform logistics, we can transform people transportation simply by looking at it in a new way, which is why I'm calling this bringing the paradigm shift. Let's look at it in a new way, a completely new way. Don't look at the same solutions we've been looking at for the same problems year after year. Look at it differently. Okay, so as I said, we have to go up in there. That's the only way. We can't use more right-of-way, or we can't use the same right-of-way over and over and over again. Two benefits come out immediately. One is you can still use the land below. Second benefit is I don't need three-dimensional wisdom. And with all due respect, the stuff that you guys are coming up with is absolutely brilliant. We do not have that type of knowledge in Africa. We do not have that type of engineering. We can't maintain those systems. But if you go up in the air and you've got one cart in front of you, one behind you, you've got one directional intelligence. That's all you need. Where's the one in front of me? So it becomes a simpler technology. We then created a couple of elements. A switching system that's very simple. There's no moving parts on the track. So first of all, it's up in the air. Then there's a switching mechanism that's got no moving parts on the track. Then we created the low-cost infrastructure. Our track costs less than $2 million per kilometer for a double track. Less than $2 million for a double track that's 7 meters up in the air. And we can transport up to 15 tons units on them. And there's a couple of other things that we added. So we had to create a couple of elements that enables the system to work differently from anything else. We then had to build it and test it. So we built a system on a 90-meter system, an internal laboratory, where we ran it for a couple of weeks until we decided we've learned enough to go over the next phase. And this was an interesting thing. Because I'm not an engineer, I come from the IT world. We don't believe there's anything we can't do. And the engineers still tell us there's physical laws we can't go beyond. So what we say is, okay, let's find out those physical laws as quickly as we possibly can. So instead of spending 3 months designing, build it and tell me if it works or not. And if you do, in 3 months, build three of them. And by the time you're finished, you've learned more than you can ever do on paper. And that's what we did. So we went out, we built it, we built four different versions of it. You can see there how quickly we did the migration from the first versions to the last versions. I learned a lot, learned an incredible amount of information in a very short space of time. And then we went outdoors, we built a 1 kilometer test track, because frankly there's no use you build a third scale model, because the laws that you want to, the physical laws that you want to test does not apply on a third scale. We know an electric motor works, we know steel on steel works, we know all these things, so why go and test it on scale? What you want to know is, can you move 15 tons on this thing and will it break? Can you stop this thing on a downhill? So we had to build a 1 kilometer track. We then built a mining system on there, a haulage system that's based on very, very simple technologies. Electric motor, battery. Okay, those of you with sharp eyes will realize that's not a battery, that's a generator. It was another shortcut we took. So, we are not battery engineers. We can buy batteries, but we need a power source. We don't want copper in there, because in Africa our copper gets stolen. In fact, our steel gets stolen. In fact, our bolts get stolen. So we had to design this whole thing that is almost foolproof and is as little possible that people want to steal. We then started testing the system. And all I'm going to show you on this one over here. It's running. It's just a couple of video clips of the system running. So this has been running for the past 12 months. And we've learned an incredible amount of information in a fairly short space of time. That over there is the driving system. It weighs a couple of hundred kilograms and you can pull 15 tons with it. The gripping system works on the principle of the top wheel and the bottom wheels. And as the top wheel moves forward, it grips between the top and the bottom. So we create our own grip without requiring our own weight. By doing that, we can go from horizontal to vertical and back to horizontal again. Land below can still be used. You can even use it for agricultural land. You'll notice that there's a lot of wheels in the system. So what we did was we spread our weight out so that our superstructure only needs to carry 1 ton per meter. In fact, it's designed for 2 tons per meter, but by doing it 1 ton per meter, I can carry 10 tons over 10 meters. That's an air brake system, same as that they use in trucks, so that when there's a fatal flaw, the system sits on its own brakes, so that the heavier the system is, the quicker it brakes. Electric motor in the front, control box in the back. Most of these things off-the-shelf components. We made a couple of mistakes along the way. We designed our own motor. It's a beauty. It generates, it's a 120 kilowatt motor weighing 60 kilograms. And it's still standing, gathering dust, because it's a lot smarter to go for off-the-shelf components. Again, if you look at this is the switch. There's no moving part on the track. The unit itself has got a single moving part deciding whether it's going to go left or whether it's going to go right. And the reason for that is if you've got two moving parts, one goes left, one stays right, you've got a fatal flaw. If there's one moving part and something goes wrong right in the middle, it will be forced to go either left or right. And when it goes left, it turns the wheel so that everything follows behind it. Sunset in Africa is beautiful. You must come and see it. The height of the system, we can go up to, we can theoretically go to almost any height. And it runs uphill and downhill. Okay, having said that, I just quickly want to show you this one as well. This is a downhill brake test. Okay, so what we did here was we had, in this case, it's 4 tons moving downhill at about a four degree incline or decline. And we tried to test the safety system. So as it speeds up, we throw the brakes, and I did not use a professional photographer for this, so I do apologize. And then we hit the brakes, and you can see how quickly it stops. So, that's the system. We then redesigned the superstructure so that it is affordable, easy to erect, super strong, and what we came up with was a system that is now classified as a new structural element, or a new class of structural element. And we were forced to do that due to our circumstances. The business, as you said, there's four companies we had to create. We couldn't go to market with mining systems and people systems in the same company. Those two markets are completely, completely different. The one is a miner that wants lowest cost. The other one is people that need safety and politicians and PPPs and bots. So there's two companies we created, Podcast Africa and Milotech. Milotech, we created the Ork Veyor system, which is the one carrying mining systems, mining ore and materials. And for that, we created a very simple mechanism where we've got various types of skips. But the one most commonly used at the moment is a rotating skip, where we load it the one way, and then when we discharge, we simply rotate it in a circle and it bottom discharges. Very simple, straightforward simplicity. The track has been redesigned, as I said, to be extremely strong and robust. Superstructure has been created so that we do it like Meccano said, so we can build this thing very, very quickly, very, very rapidly, and we even rent out the systems to clients. And when they stop paying, we take our track back. It's not even a permanent structure anymore. We then start applying it to mining companies. Conveyor belts, trucks, trains, you've got no idea how big the market is. We were surprised. This is, for instance, for one of our coal mines. Our price came in at a third of the current rates that they use with trucks. Underground mines, some of the biggest underground mining companies at the moment are investing money in our system to research what it's going to do for them. According to their calculations, they can save 40% of underground mining costs by using the system. But again, they're telling us, do you know what this is going to do for us? And that's the exciting part, is they're literally teaching us. They're investing in finding out how this will change their lives. It's a new way of transporting, so we're still exploring how it can be applied. This is another mining company, and then this one over here. We've just sold the first system, so it's not a theoretical system anymore. I'm not sleeping very well at the moment because we have to go live, and it's now a contract. It's not a dream anymore. And if you've got a contract and you skip it, you've got $1 million of damage around the corner, which is different from R&D. I just came out of R&D phase and I have to rush into delivery phase. So this project over here is to carry 350,000 tons of coal per month. Put that in your pipe and smoke it. I did it in the beginning. The client said 50,000 tons, and I thought, yeah. And the next meeting said, oh, we signed another contract. It's now 350,000 tons. Okay? The bottom line is, if we can move that, we can move people. This system over here has to cross a railway line, believe it or not. We're going 17 meters up in the air to cross the railway line. And we're going live on the 1st of April. So from there to go to people, simple, straightforward. It's exactly the same technology. Except it's not 14 tons anymore. It's now 2 or 3 tons. Our people systems are designed with safety mechanisms built into them. The red ends, those are fail-safe mechanisms that if everything goes wrong, they can still crash into each other without the units actually touching. Our stations are designed to sit on the pavements. I'm going to say this again. We are in Africa. Our problem is not having another solution. Our problem is we don't have any solutions. We need a first solution. So we've got roads, we've got pavements, but we don't have transportation systems. So the only way we can do that is go into the pavements, use the road, suspend it above the road, park on the side, have your station so narrow that you can fit them anywhere, every 200 meters. Put solar power on them. That's one thing we do have in Africa, it's a lot of sunshine. And the last thing I want to mention here is we also have a huge drive in South Africa specifically for people with disabilities. So put an elevator in there. So the station's width is actually determined by the width of the elevator. Now these stations will be positioned almost everywhere. The system is completely on demand, the people transportation system. You call it with your mobile phone. You go from your station where you are to where you want to be, and it doesn't stop in between. It just passes everything else in between. The time saving is enormous. But if you want to use it as a taxi service, i.e. I don't want to pay $1 for this, I want to pay 50 cents for it, then you can share it with other people, moving pretty much the same direction. Our grid networks that we've worked out for people transportation enables us to be within 500 meters of a station anywhere. If you have two lines running, a kilometer apart, you're never more than 500 meters apart from a station. If you now build those tracks at $2 million US per kilometer, it's not difficult to do 300 kilometers of this track in the city and see how far that gets you. Okay, so once you do that and you don't have the problem of stopping anymore, then you don't need that much parking space that we're using in our highways at the moment. And that is what African traffic looks like in the mornings. I kid you not. In and out. If you take that problem away, time is not the issue anymore. Or distance is not the issue anymore. Now time is the issue. So suddenly property starts changing. Instead of having everything close to each other, it's okay to be 15 minutes apart. If you can travel 10 kilometers in 15 minutes, then location is not the rule of property anymore. It is now, am I connected to the network? Once you start doing that, you change the dynamics of how you build a city. Take Cape Town, for instance. This is the one city you do know. Those of you that don't know Dar es Salaam, I hope you know Cape Town. So we are actually in detailed discussions right now with the city of Cape Town. And for them, this changes everything. It is they're trying to solve the transportation problems at the moment in the current modes. By doing this, they transform the city. It gives them the potential to do that. The same thing with Durban. The same thing with Port Elizabeth. East London. So these are all cities, Johannesburg, Pretoria, all talking to us. And we want to start talking about job creation. Suddenly we don't need big trucks anymore. You can have lots of people moving smaller packets from point to point, which is something that doesn't happen in Africa at the moment. And then the last thing I want to say is we also sold our first people transportation system. Wow. The University of Pretoria, the Vice Chancellor is saying, when do you start? And we're saying, we tried to put together a team. So guys, please, we've created this opportunity. We created it from different circumstances, but now we need your help. This is everyone's opportunity. If this community wants to take this to the next level, please join us. Thank you.